Welcome to Rock of Faith. You're about to watch a service of March 30th, Wednesday evening with Pastor Jess Tuthill. You can submit prayer requests, offerings, and find everything at our website, roffont.com. The link is in the video description below.
Praise the Lord. Good evening, everyone. It's good to see each one here tonight. We say God bless you. We have lots of things to pray for tonight. We don't want to forget to do that. Lori Gibson is in Kaiser Fontana. We believe that she had a heart attack, and they're giving her a lot more tests tomorrow, and one of them will be an angiogram. So we need to really lift her up. They have her on morphine and nitroglycerin, so we really need to pray for her. Tony Cota is in San Antonio. And he has a problem with his heart as well. We'll just say it this way. One of Gail's friends is seriously ill, and she won't be here tonight. She's with her friend, and so let's pray for her friend. I don't have a name, but let's just pray for Gail. Jordan. Okay, let's remember Jordan tonight. She has a real need. Amen. We're trying to think of anybody else. Let's not forget Sharon. Sharon's going for surgery next Wednesday. Will be Sharon's surgery at 11 o'clock at Hoke Hospital. Let's remember Kenny. Kenny's doing better. They're trying to find a light duty job for Kenny. So let's pray for Kenny tonight. And I talked to Ruby, and she's doing better, going through physical therapy. She's still not up to being able to drive. And so as soon as she's able to drive, she'll be back in church. So let's remember Ruby. And let's remember Juanis and Debbie tonight. Both of them really need our prayer as well. Praise the Lord. Yes, Mary? Okay, let's remember this family. Okay, someone else as we're going to prayer. Anybody at all? Margo? Okay. Okay. Let's remember Phyllis. Yes, Leon. Okay. Let's remember these. My son is doing much better. He is back to work, and he can travel and drive and do the things he needs to do. So let's keep praying for him, though. He's still got a ways to go. They're going to give him another MRI. I think he said the first part of May, and if everything looks good, then they're going to start weaning him off the Coumadin. So let's remember him for that. Amen. Yeah. It takes a while. Once you start Coumadin, it takes a while to get you off of that. So, yes.
And I also have a request for my uncle. He's also in the hospital with chest pains tonight.
Okay. Let's remember his uncle tonight. Amen. Anyone else as we're going to prayer? All right, would you stand with me? We're going to take all of these requests to the Lord in prayer tonight. We're glad that you're here. Amen. If you would, turn to your neighbor and tell him, I love you and you can't do nothing about it. Tell him, I love you and you can't do nothing about it. Amen. And if you would, repeat after me and say, this is the best day and the best year that I've ever had, because Jesus is with me. One more time. This is the best day and the best year that I've ever had, because Jesus is with me. Let's give him a clap offering tonight. Amen. Let's lift up all these requests tonight. We've got lots of people that need our prayers. So let's lift them up and let's believe God to touch them in their body. Amen. Father, we thank you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus for this wonderful opportunity to be in your house. And Lord, we lift up all of these people, Lord, we know that need a touch of healing. Lord, we lift up Lori tonight, Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, as she goes for tests tomorrow, Lord, we pray that you'll fix everything that's wrong, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we lift up Kenny tonight. God, we pray that you'll open a door for him on his job. Father God, we lift up this uncle, Father, in the name of Jesus. We pray that you will touch, Lord, minister to the needs. We lift up Sister Sharon, Lord, as she's going next week for surgery. God, we pray that that would be perfect, Lord, that they bring restoration to her physical body. Father, we lift up Debbie and Juanice, Lord, tonight. In the name of Jesus, Father God, we lift up Jordan tonight. Father God, we pray for a miracle in her life. Take away that depression and discouragement. Lord, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we lift up each and every one, Lord, that needs a touch in their body tonight, God. Everyone, this other family that needs a touch, God. Everyone that made a mention of a request in prayer, we send the word of healing and deliverance, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray for our service tonight. We pray that you'll stir up the gifts of the Spirit and the power of God. Bless everything that we do, Lord, all the music, the spoken word, Lord, everything that we do tonight, Lord, that you will minister to the needs of your people. And Lord, we'll give you the glory, the praise, and the honor. Thank you for your mercy. Touch us tonight. Minister to the needs of the people, God. We'll give you glory. We give you praise, and we give you honor. Yes, Lord, and we ask all these things tonight in your name, the name of Jesus, and everyone said, amen. Let's give him another clap offering tonight, if you would. You can be seated tonight, if you will. Praise the Lord. If it's all right, we're going to do a song now. If you would, let's join. Just, if you know it, you can join in, but we're going to hear this song. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's a good old-fashioned song. Amen. But we're going to go ahead and receive our evening tithe and offering at this time. Anything you can do to help us is certainly appreciated. We're glad that you're here tonight. Praise the Lord. Father, we thank you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus once again for the offering. We ask you to bless the gift and the giver, Lord. Some way, somehow, return it to your people, and we'll thank you for it. We give you glory, praise, and honor. We ask it tonight in your name, the name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. If you have an offering, please bring it to the storehouse of the Lord. Praise the Lord. We have a few announcements tonight we don't want to forget. Coming up on the 9th, the ladies are going to meet here at the church. The ladies group will meet at 10:30. Teresa will be speaking, and they're going to have hot dogs, and it's potluck, and so I know the ladies are going to have some fun with that. Pastor Dan will be with us on the 10th of April, and he'll be here both morning and evening. On the 24th, we have Sister Carol Dickey and Robert Greenlaw going to be ministering on the 24th. I got a call from Pastor Art this week, and they're going to be doing some men things at his church on the 4th. If anyone would like to go, I'm going to try to make it on the 4th. They have a very special men's meeting at his church, which is Thursday, and it will be at 7 o'clock. And coming up on the 26th, he's going to have Kimberly Dearman, which is our supervisor. She's outgoing now, and they have a new supervisor, Fernando. And they're going to be sharing what's going to be happening, the transfer. And so all the whole church is actually welcome for that one. That will be coming up on the 26th. Amen. On the 10th, they're going to do something special in the evening service, but we'll be here, and so it's going to be kind of hard for us to do both. But he is having some special events this month at his church up there. I'm going to try to make a couple of them. I think the 26th is a Tuesday. Is that correct? I think so. I think the 24th is the Sunday. Yeah, they're going to Carol Dickey will be here on the 24th, so the 26th is a Tuesday. And so we're looking forward to those events and stuff. That's all a part of Foursquare. So let's remember these events. And on the 30th is the ladies' banquet, the mother-daughter banquet. All the ladies are invited. And it's going to be at Mimi's Cafe. There's a flyer on the entryway on our bulletin board. If you will look at that, you can get tickets. Or if you want a ticket and you don't have the money now, just let us know and we'll mark down a space for you. They have 50 seats and that's all we can do. So if you want to go, you need to let them know. And they will make a place for you. Praise the Lord. Trying to think of anything else. I think that's it. Let's not forget our staff meeting on the first Sunday, 5:00. And that will be on the 3rd. And then on the 10th is our board meeting, advisory board meeting, and that will be at 5:00 as well. Praise the Lord. Would you turn to your neighbor and smile really big and tell them, this is a friendly church. Amen. This is a friendly church. Amen. Amen. Well, I guess we're going to do this. Can we? Oh, no, go ahead and bring us up to date, if you would, on the internet, if you would, please. Thank you.
Sure. We're doing fantastic. These numbers are all from the 28th. We're at 8,727 views. As I shared Sunday, our new countries are Bangladesh and Senegal. Our top countries are Canada, UK, and Singapore. Our top states are Missouri, Georgia, and Oregon. We're doing really good. All of Easter service has been put up, including all these specials. I can tell you that people are really liking all the music from that service because the views have already skyrocketed, and we don't even have official counts for that yet. Also, because of Easter, we discovered that we had a slight problem, that we couldn't do our color correctly. Under certain points, we had some difficulties, and Pastor is allowing us to get a very simple mechanism to where that won't happen again. We can always standardize our color, because very few people will see that until it looks really wrong, which parts of Easter did. We tried to do our best to get it correctly, but all digital cameras record color and light incorrectly. While it's simple to fix that, you have to know what you're going to, what the standard is. So very soon we will have our set standard, and that won't happen again. So we're doing good, and all the services from now on will be standardized.
All right. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Well, I want to thank everyone for participating in Easter. We had a wonderful service on Sunday, and there were over 100 people here on Sunday, which is really good for us. Praise the Lord. And we just need to crowd them and get them every Sunday. Amen. We'd like to see them here all the time. But anyway, it was a beautiful service. It was a wonderful time. And then we had the Passion of the Christ on Sunday night. And we just had a few people, but it was really good. I really enjoyed watching that. It really shares the suffering that Christ suffered for our salvation. Amen. So very, very, very special. We praise the Lord for that. Amen. We do have one visitor tonight. Let's give our visitor a nice warm welcome. We say God bless you. We're glad you're here tonight. Amen. Amen. We're glad that you're here tonight. Praise the Lord. Amen. We're going to have one more song tonight before we do our Bible study. And so, guys, if you could play that, I appreciate it. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, tonight we're going to be in Psalm 51 and 1 John. Very similar scripture. Amen. In fact, it's one right after the other. Praise the Lord. We're going to ask our sister Mary Lee, would you ask the blessing on the word tonight, please? All right. Psalm 51. I don't know if we're going to read the whole thing, but let's just start in verse 10 tonight. This is a psalm of David after he had sinned, and he's calling upon the name of the Lord. And I want to share some things tonight. Verse 10 says, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me by your generous spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall be converted to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, the God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall show forth your praise. For you do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it. You do not delight in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise." And let's turn over real quick to 1 John chapter 1. Verse 9, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And if we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us." Verse 9, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." I want to take some time tonight, and I want you to recognize the significance of this prayer of David. Most of us are aware of the love and the preciousness of God, but I want to share how precious that the Lord is with King David in this situation. We know the story, how that David saw the beautiful woman as he was on his balcony, and she was bathing, and he went, and they made love, and she conceived a child. And the child did die, but David, in the process of his transgression, sent the husband of Bathsheba to the battlefield. His name was Uriah. And Uriah died on the front lines. And David took Bathsheba into his house. The child that was due to be born was born, but he died. And David made intercession for himself and for the situation that he found himself in. I want us to understand how important prayer is. God gives us opportunity to make things right, and sometimes he will even go beyond what we deserve. He'll go beyond what would be a natural, or go beyond what is fair, in even according to the scriptures. We want to learn, and I feel like God is dealing with me about some things. We shared a little bit earlier about it. But people are running into more and more difficult situations. They're running into more and more financial situations where they do not have the finances to do things. They're running into physical situations where sickness is trying to overtake them. And I want to take some time tonight about this. The Bible says that God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think, according to the power that works in us. In this situation that David found himself in, the reality of this situation is that both David and Bathsheba should have been taken outside the city and stoned to death. That's according to the law. They should have been killed for their transgressions. But as David is interceding for his life and for his soul, God looks down upon David and begins to see the sincerity of his prayer. I often try to encourage people when they pray to be sincere, number one, and to line their prayer up with the Word of God. You do not know what that will do in the presence of an Almighty God. When Hezekiah was sick and was about to die, Isaiah came to him and told him he was going to die and not live. Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and cried out to God. And he reminded the Lord all the things that he had done. And he reminded the Lord that he'd been faithful and reminded God of his obedience. And so Isaiah didn't even get out of the king's household. He was in the courtyard. And God spoke to him. He said, go back and tell Hezekiah that I will add to his life 15 years. And so God used Isaiah, amen, in a special way. But Hezekiah's prayer changed his life. David's prayer here changed his whole destination. That God listened to what he had to say, but they were both sincere prayers, and God did beyond what either one of them thought that God would do. We sometimes think God is so set in stone that he can't bend, he's not flexible, that whatever is said is set in stone. And the reality of it is that he is a living God. He is a God that hears our prayer. He is a God that knows our heart. He's a God that can do anything. He's a God that can do the things that are needed in our lives, and even more so. We are finding ourselves, and I'm trying to get people to get more involved, and we're teaching more involved about healing. In Isaiah 53, it says, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Those words mean sicknesses and pains. And we see in Matthew 8, 16, and 17 that Jesus went out in the wilderness and healed all that were out there. And it said that it might be fulfilled by the prophet Isaiah that himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. And so we see that physical healing was necessary in this day and hour that Jesus came to the earth. And many of us now, more and more people are in a place where they do not have insurance or money to take care of their physical concerns. I believe this is an hour where God would like to step into your prayer and advance what the Word of God says to bring healing and deliverance to your physical body. God is trying to get us to understand how important prayer is and how important a sincere prayer can avail much, as James said. Something that we do in the presence of God when we pray in line with the Spirit, how powerful that is in God's presence. So many churches do things on what I call automatic pilot. They say a prayer over and over and over and over and over again. They will say the Lord's Prayer over and over and over again. They will say any kind of prayer over and over and over again. And there is nothing that's heartfelt. There's nothing that's sincere. They just pray it and in repetition. And sometimes they say the prayer hundreds of times, and they may not even mean it once. They just say it because it's religious. And Jesus said when he was here, you will not be heard for your much speaking. He said the scribes and Pharisees are not heard for their much speaking. So you could pray for hours and hours and hours and still not be effective if you don't mean what you're praying about. Can I get a witness? Amen. And so a sincere prayer is always going to avail much more than just a repetitious prayer that we pray over and over and over and over again. It's not going to move God. It's not going to affect him. I find myself in situations that God wants to help me, and it's up to me to respond to what the Word of God says. And here, if you don't understand what I'm saying, in Psalms 51, David and Bathsheba should have been killed. David is interceding before God, and God is going to grant mercy to David and to Bathsheba. He's going to forgive them of their transgressions, and he's going to let them live when they should not live. All of us probably have sinned enough that all of us should be dead. Hello, we should have been died or close to it, amen, something to it. And the reality of it is God saw mercy upon us and granted us grace so that he knew the day we'd get saved, and he knew how to keep us safe until we got to that day. And I know for me, there's been times, especially before I became a Christian, where I had some near experiences and I probably should be dead. But thank God I'm not, and the grace of God is with me to deliver me. Hallelujah. Amen. We see other people, amen, that God moved in special ways when they began to pray. Joshua told the sun to stand still and the moon to stand still, and they did so he could win the battle. Elijah called fire down out of heaven to consume the sacrifice. Over and over and over, we see where prayer availed much in the Old Testament for people. Jehoshaphat sent the tribe of Judah, which is praised, to the battlefield. And they won the battle with just praise. Amen. Most of us probably wouldn't do that. I don't think you could call a general in the United States Army and tell them to send the praise team out to the battlefield and they'd listen to you. They're not going to do that. But in this day, the praise team got the victory for Israel. Amen. They won a great battle. Amen. And it's important. You're awful quiet tonight. Amen. We have to understand tonight how powerful God's word is. We have to understand that when we pray, that God is really wanting to do something special for his people. This is not my church. This is God's church. You are not my people. You are God's people. You are special in the sight of God. God loves you, and he wants to protect you and do things that will provide things for you, that will protect you when you're out on the highways, to do things to help his children. Amen. And the only way that we're going to get there is if we'll learn how to pray, amen, and ask God to do the things that we have need of. Sometimes we do sin. I didn't get an amen on that at all. Amen. Sometimes we do sin. And so when we pray, we have to understand, if God can forgive David and Bathsheba of all the things that they did in this situation and forgave them, what makes you think he's not going to forgive you? Why, he can do more. If he did it for them and you have not committed this kind of a sin, even if you did, God extends his hand of forgiveness so you can receive restoration. That's why during the day I try to remind myself, Lord, if I've said anything, if I've done anything that's displeasing to you, may you forgive me that I might be restored. And according to 1 John, it says that if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That means everything we've done that's not according to God's word, we can be forgiven of that, and he can take it, and we can be blessed by his might and his power. Amen. I want to get into heaven. I don't want to just go to church. When I pray, I want to be sincere when I pray. I want to pray a good prayer and not just any kind of a prayer. I don't want to pray it over and over and over and over again. I don't mean it mean, but I went into a service one time where they said the same prayer 50 times, and then they said it in Spanish, and then they said it in English again. And they said it over and over and over and over and over and over again. And I don't know if they ever said it in sincerity, but it's not going to do you any good to say something over and over and over. I always share this many years ago. I was a brand new Christian, and I came to church, and I knelt at the altar, and I was praying, and there was a person next to me. And they prayed this prayer, and I thought, this prayer is so beautiful, so wonderful. And so the next service I came to, I knelt next to this person, and they prayed this exact same words, every word the same. They didn't alter one thing. Amen. And then I went again, the next service we came, and I prayed, and I was near this person, and they prayed the same prayer, every word the same, nothing different. Well, I tell you, if you get next to a person like that after a while, you don't want to hear the person pray. You know exactly what word they're going to say. They memorized the prayer, and probably it's not heartfelt. Hello? God wants something that's heartfelt. Amen? Some people I know sing the exact same songs every week in church. It's awful quiet. The Bible says to sing unto the Lord a new song. He'd like to hear a different one once in a while. Hello? Come on. He'd like to hear something that's heartfelt too. I got to catch myself because I know hundreds of songs. And if somebody starts a song, I can probably pick up the tune and sing it, and I probably know the verses or at least a couple of them. But my problem is I could be thinking of the football game or something to eat or whatever else, amen, because it's memorized. It's not something that is necessarily heartfelt, and worship, amen, is supposed to be heartfelt. We're supposed to be honoring God. Can I get a witness? We're supposed to be honoring with praise, honor him with the word, honor him with whatever we're doing in the church service with our prayer life, and so that he'll be pleased, amen. We're supposed to be the type of people that will, amen, make things right, allow God to forgive us, amen. And many times in church services, people don't even get a chance to pray. They have a 60-minute service, and they're in and out. They crank them in and crank them out. And Spirit of God may not even have a chance to get things fixed up with people. And the reality of it, God wants to hear your voice. God wants you to learn how to pray and be sincere so he can do for you what he did for David and he did for John and what he did for other people. Amen. I find myself amazed. Amen. Amazed at the fact that people do not put confidence in prayer like they used to. It's awful quiet in this place. They don't put confidence in prayer. Inside here, they really are not sure, or they don't believe that God is going to answer them. Hello? And so they don't pray. Pastor Dan says this way, that he knows your spiritual attitude by how much you pray or how much you don't pray. He knows if you have confidence in God by your prayer life. And I understand that, because if you don't pray, God's not going to hear you. He can't do anything for anybody unless they pray. Amen. I was talking to someone one time, excuse me, and they were trying to say that the church wasn't necessary, that you can do the same thing at home. And I began to read the Bible, and I began to find out there's definite statements about the church. Yeah, well, there's a lot of scriptures. I'll share a few of them. One of them is, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves. Ephesians 4 says that there are apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers in the church. Not outside the church, not in your home, but in the church. Hello. It's to build up the church. Amen. I'm preaching to me. Amen. Gifts of the Spirit are to operate in the church service. Hello. Tongues, interpretation, prophecy, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, gifts of healing and miracles, etc., etc. These are to operate in the church. There's rules for those to operate during the church service. It also says, covet to prophesy and forbid not to speak with tongues. So all those things are instruments that will build up the church that are supposed to be taking place in the church. Amen? They're supposed to be part of the church service, and that means there should be a church somewhere. Is that right? There should be a church somewhere where the apostle can go to, and the prophet, and the evangelist, and the pastor, and the teacher. Come on, amen. Where the gifts operate, people can be prayed for. You can call somebody. What does it say? Call for the elders of the church. Let them anoint you with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick. Where do they do that? They do it in the church. Hello? Hello? And I realize that somebody got offended in the church. And I find this often in commentaries where things didn't work out for the person making the commentary. And so they changed what the word says to meet their spiritual condition. Hello. And so somebody prayed, amen, one time and said, it's one saved, always saved. Well, I like it too. Well, I only have to pray one prayer. And I'm good for the rest of my life. You know where I'd be tonight if I only had to pray one prayer of sin, of repentance, and I got forgiven? I would be at the beach right now. Can I get a witness? Amen. And I will enjoy the rest of my life. But it doesn't work that way. Hello. I would be doing something, nothing else. I'll be hanging with the dogs. Can I get a witness? Amen. It doesn't work that way. And that's what I'm teaching here. Why would God tell us how to pray and do such great and mighty things through prayer if we're not supposed to pray? He did exceedingly beyond what people thought he would do when they prayed. He did great and mighty things. He won battles. One man won a battle with candles, pitchers, and a trumpet. Amen. 300 people wiped out the enemy. Amen. That's another battle I don't think I'd send a candle, a pitcher, and a trumpet to go. Amen. You don't understand. Have you ever had any enemies? These enemies of Israel hated them. If you go down to these countries that are around about Israel, they hate Israel. They don't just dislike them. They hate them. Yeah, they don't want to just, give them a little trouble. They give them trouble all the time. Bomb places and do all kinds of stuff. Terrible stuff to Israel because they hate them. Amen. One of these days, you're going to understand that the devil doesn't like you. In fact, he hates you. And that's the reason you have so much trouble. The devil is trying to get you to stop doing what you do. And lots of people I know, amen, once they get started in this, don't understand there's going to be opposition. The devil is not going to just step out of your way and let you go do what you want to do. Amen. And that's why you need to pray even more. If you want to gain victory, if you want to advance, you're going to have to keep doing this and pursue it until you gain victory. Hallelujah. Oh, help me. Amen. I don't know. You don't have to raise your hand. But there are lots of times I go long periods of time doing pretty well in my Christian life. And then all of a sudden I'll have a day where I'll do something that's out of the ordinary from what I normally do. I'll say the wrong thing or do the wrong thing. And it really upsets me because I thought I had that thing under control. I'm the only one. Amen. And it really will bother me because I'll do something and I know I shouldn't do it, but I did it anyway. I can't get out of it. Amen. God saw me do it. I did it. I wish I hadn't done it, but I did it. Amen. And then I'll go another long period of time and I'll think I'll have it under control. And then I'll do it again. Amen. It bothers me because my human nature is a mess. My human nature is not consistent like the Spirit is. And there are times as I'm praying and believing and trusting that my spirit man is in control. And then all of a sudden, maybe I won't pray enough or whatever it is I'll do anyway. My flesh will take control. And pretty soon I'll say something and do something that I thought, what? Oh, God, why did I do that? Amen. If this scripture isn't in the Bible, I'm in trouble tonight. If I can't call upon the name of the Lord after I say something or do something that's sinful, I'm in trouble tonight. Hello. I don't do it on purpose. Some days I don't even think about it, but some days I just say something and I thought, oh, I should have never said that. I said the wrong thing. Before I became a minister, remember this, I'll never forget this. I try to watch what I say to people. But a man came in the church and hadn't been in the church for a long time. And when he came in the church, initially I didn't mean something negative, but I just said, hello, brother, God bless you. Where have you been? And when I said that to him, I could say, you said the wrong thing. And I saw his eyes hit the floor. And I saw him shuffle his feet because he and I both knew he wasn't doing what he's supposed to, or he would have been in the church. And so I learned, you know what? You need to keep your big mouth shut. And when somebody comes to church, you need to say, thank you. It's good to see you tonight or today or whenever it is. Bless you for being here. And then keep your mouth shut. Don't ask them where they've been. Amen. I'm preaching to me. That's the kind of thing that gets me into trouble. Hello. And I've seen people say things to others and they never ask for forgiveness. This scripture here tells me that I'm in trouble if I don't get things corrected with God. If I don't have a prayer life of forgiveness, you cannot tell me you do everything right. I don't even want to hear it. At some point in your life, you got to say, God, I'm sorry. I did it again. I said it again. I don't know why, but I did it again. God, I don't know. How can I not do this for months at a time and then all of a sudden I do it again? Yeah, whatever. I had times where, I'll give you an example where I think people could say things to me and I won't be angry. They could say this, whatever it is, to me. And then all of a sudden they say it to me and I get mad. And I'll get angry and I'll say something I shouldn't say. I don't usually cuss somebody or like that, but I'll say something rude back. And then the Spirit of God tells me, you have to go ask for forgiveness. Now I have another battle. I don't want to ask for forgiveness. I ain't asking forgiveness. You heard what they said to me. Hello. It's a fleshly battle right here going on. You got to go ask for forgiveness. One day at work, when I was at work one day, guy said something to me and I said something smart back to him. And I didn't like what he had to say, but the Holy Spirit was on me all day. Go apologize and say you're sorry. I said, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. He said that terrible to me. I'm not going to do it. All day the Holy Spirit was on me. Amen. I mean, a long time. I was rebellious for hours. And finally I thought, you know, you better go say you're sorry. And so I decided, you know what? I'm sorry. I go over there and I said, look, I'm sorry. And I told myself, that was the last night I said, I'm ever coming into this building without praying. from now on, I'm going to pray either at night or in the morning before I ever come into this place. And do you know, I never had to apologize to that person ever again because I didn't let my flesh take control. I made sure that I prayed and was under subjection before I went in the building. Hallelujah. You can do it. Takes you some time, you can do it. But I realize I'm a threefold being. I'm spirit, soul, and body. Hello? That is why your soul is your mind, your emotions, and your intellect, and your will. This is the house you live in. And the spirit is the real you. But if you let your emotions carry you, you're going to let anger, jealousy, envy, whatever, they will control you. They will. That's part of your being. Come on, you can watch good programs on TV, and then all of a sudden your mind says, you know what, why don't you watch this other channel? Hello. And you know you're not supposed to watch it. And you don't watch 5 minutes, you watch the entire program. Damn, I do. And then I'm back at it. Oh, God, I did it again. And I've got to go pray again, Lord. I'm so sorry. Once I went to this program, I couldn't believe this thing. It wasn't really, they weren't really doing this stuff. They were making fun of witchcraft is what they did, this program. And it took me at least 2 hours after I saw this program to pray myself back to a peace, and they weren't even doing it on purpose. It was just making fun of it. And here I am watching it when I know better that I'm not supposed to listen to ungodly witchcraft anything. Don't watch it. Don't listen to it. Yeah, not even in a joke. Don't listen to it. Well, I learned my lesson. Someone said, would you like to see that again? I said, ain't going to happen. And I spent 2 hours praying myself under. I'm not watching that again. So I find myself, and I like what Psalmist David did, that the way through life is through the Word of God because He's merciful. The way through life is through prayer and through worship. The way through life is to be led of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. The way to get through your problems is in this book. No other way you can do it. There's no other religion that can help you get control of your emotions, your mind, your intellect, and your will, your desires, except the Word of God and the Spirit of God. It's the only way you can do it. There's no other prophet, no other teacher, no religion, nobody can help you get under control except Jesus. Look at Jesus. We just got done. We just got done with Easter. Jesus is on the cross, and the thief looks over to him, and he says, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said, this day you'll be with me in paradise. And I got to studying. I've been studying this week, and they're talking about Jesus' character. They're talking about how Jesus is. And when we pray, if we're listening to that, we are praying and we're depending on His nature to help us. And even though most of us wouldn't help us when we sin, there is somebody that has a better attitude, better character, better intellect, more mercy, more kindness, more love, that when we ask Him to do something in line with His word, He's character enough to forgive you and set you free. I'm gonna bless me tonight if I don't bless anybody else. I'm depending on it tonight. Because I got a problem with my flesh. Not every day, but I have a problem with it. I'm doing better and better on my diet. But even on certain days, that stuff looks so good, I'm going to have me some of it. Hello. I've been doing better and better, but I go down there, oh man, I gotta have some more of this. I always share though, I'm looking on the cans, I love Denison's chili. Thank God I haven't had any in a long time. There's almost 2,000 milligrams of salt in the can of chili. In one serving, there's, I think it's 800 or 950 milligrams. In one serving, a half a can. Do you know how much a half a can of chili is? My doctor said I could have 2,000 milligrams a day of salt, and I really try to keep it under that because I've been trying to do my blood pressure. I have a machine at home that I can take my blood pressure, and I like to keep it where it's supposed to be. I can't go back to what I used to do, and I really haven't done that. But I have days where I just got to have some of that stuff. Hello? And it's different. There's many weeks where I will watch myself all week long so I can have a little treat at the end of the week. And I can do that. But there's some stuff I'm just not supposed to eat. And I find myself, I'll give you a good example. Since I'm not supposed to eat it, and I haven't eaten it in months, when I eat it, because I haven't had, say, greasy, whatever, fried something or other, and I take a couple bites of fried food, I will get sick. I won't always get bad sick, but I will feel bad. I will eat certain foods or maybe do something, drink something I haven't drank. It has 30% sodium in it. Hello? I haven't had one in months and I take one. It makes me feel bad. I haven't had it. My body hasn't had it. And my body says, you're not supposed to have this. Amen. And then I feel bad. My physical body doesn't like it because I haven't put it in there in months. I'm preaching to me. Amen. What a battle. Oh, it tastes so good, the devil says. Oh, it looks so good. What did he say to Eve and the tree? Oh, it'll make you smart. You'll love it. It'll be so good. Same story. What, we haven't learned it? It's the same story. So here we are as Christians, and we are in situations, and we see people, and we see what God does for people. We've been praying, and even in this year, God's been doing great things for people. He's given people jobs. He's touched people. They're coming out of their afflictions. We prayed and prayed for sick people, and now they're starting to come out. They're getting better. Physical things are doing better and better. We have some tonight we prayed for, but we're not done praying, so don't quit tonight. Let's keep praying until we see victory, until we see God step in and see God do what he needs to do. Amen. And I don't care whether they said something or did something or for they had a reason for whatever, they're there. You could still pray them out of there because you can get healed and forgiven in the same prayer according to the book of James. And I'm finding myself, I thank God for his mercy and I thank God for his character. Let me share a few more things. When Jesus was here, he made decisions to try to help people. When the woman that was caught in the very act of adultery, and they came to him and said, the scripture says such should be stoned. What do you say? Because they wanted to catch him. And so he said, he that is without sin among you, let him cast the first stone. Well, that eliminates everybody. Can I get a witness? Amen. They dropped the stones. Amen. If you're without sin, go ahead and do it. Now, in the Old Testament, it did say that. But what did Jesus say? He said, in the Old Testament, it was an eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, love your enemies. Love those that hate you and despitefully use you. So there is a change that has to take place in the Christian to where we live like Jesus lives, because that's his character. How can you not forgive somebody, amen, that did you dirty when you've been forgiven of 8 gabillion things that you did that were wrong. And so I don't want to have an attitude that I'm not going to forgive somebody. If you've done something, my first thing should be, come on up here and let's get you restored. Galatians 6, you who are spiritual, restore such a one if someone's overtaken in a fall. Do it in the spirit of meekness. Get them restored. Amen. Yeah. You got to get people restored. You got to do things that will help people and not walk around like you're something when you know you did the same things or worse. Hello. Hello. Amen. I find myself wanting to be like Jesus was. People today find it very difficult in his life of watching his life. And as I said on Sunday about his suffering, that many people have asked me about it. Many people do not understand why Jesus had to suffer in order to pay for mankind's sin. And the answer is, God had to choose someone or something that would pay for everybody's sin. You couldn't offer some kind of lame animal or do something real cheap. Can I get a witness? I know people, amen. I know people that do cheap things. Not because they can't afford it. They could afford to do something better, but they do cheap things. I did a funeral for this family once. And I really don't know what happened between this husband and wife. But the man died, and this woman did the cheapest funeral I've ever seen in my entire life. Not that they couldn't afford it, because I know better. They bought the cheapest casket they could find. It looked just cheap, cheap, cheap. Amen. They put 3 flowers on top of the casket. Hello. Oh, you're not listening to me. Amen. I'm not saying you have to do elaborate, but when you do this on purpose to be cheap, they squeezed a quarter till they made the eagle scream on it. Amen. And I didn't say anything. I always do. I'll do my best that I can do for the service. But I'm here standing looking at this stuff, and I'm thinking, you couldn't do this on purpose any worse than what you did. Poor man, I mean, he's laying, he can't do anything about it. And so my deal was, you know what, you can still give him a good service. But often in life, the things that Jesus did, we do not replicate. We say we want to be like Jesus, but we don't replicate it. We want to love like Jesus loves. But if you mess with me, I will knock your head off. Can I get a witness? Hello? That isn't the Lord's nature. His nature was so different. His nature was contrary to what we want to do. And if we're going to develop as Christians, then we're going to have to change and adjust ourselves to where we start replicating Jesus in the earth. If we want to see somebody get saved, we're going to have to start loving them, even if they are ugly. If we want to see somebody get healed, we're going to have to start studying healing scriptures into where we build faith in here, and we can pray for somebody the prayer of faith so they can get healed. Not going to happen automatically. And sometimes you got to pray a long time to get the flesh out of the way and get the opposition out of the way to where the person can get healed. And sometimes there are issues where the other person is involved and they have to do things in order to get things straightened out in order for them to be healed. And so I find myself realizing that money isn't what I need. The word of God is so precious. I shared it the other night. It's better than silver and gold. And when you apply this the way it's supposed to, it does more than what you can think. It does more than what you're asking. Jesus is so gracious. He's better than what you're giving him credit for. Hello. He's better and he's kinder and nicer and more loving and he does things wonderfully. We find ourselves praying a prayer and we ask God to do something. And if it isn't done in 5 minutes, we're praying the same prayer again. And then we keep praying the same prayer over and over and over and over again. And sometimes in our prayer life, we treat God like he has absolutely no compassion for us whatsoever. Whether we want to admit it or not, we keep doing it over and over and over. If I went to my own earthly father when he was living and asked him for a quarter and then started begging him, oh, please give me a quarter. Oh, please give me a quarter. Oh, do you know what my earthly father would have done? If I made him embarrassed and insulted him and made him act like he wouldn't even give me a quarter, oh, I'd have a trip to the woodshed for absolutely. Amen. I'm preaching to me. Maybe your dad wouldn't like that. If I insulted my dad in any way, there was a trip to the woodshed. And if my dad didn't do it, my mother sure would. Amen. Absolutely. Amen. Amen. And here, this is in life story. We're gonna take time to pray in just a minute. This is a real story. David and Bathsheba's life were on the line. Just like Hezekiah's life was on the line. They were teetering between life and death. And David prays this prayer. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Don't cast me away from your presence and don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Teach me and instruct me in the way that I should go, and your servant will be obedient. And he was sincere when he said it. And God said, okay, David. If you'll read about it in probably 1 Samuel, you'll read about where God said, you're not going to die, David. It's going to be all right. It's going to be okay. And he didn't die, neither did Bathsheba. His son died, but then he had another son with her, and his name was Solomon. And he ruled Israel after David. Praise the Lord. I don't want to belittle what I teach here. We teach this all the time. And so I want to pray. And I don't tell people to pray and then me don't do it. I do it. And I find myself, when I do it correctly, there is overwhelming evidence of God's character that's going to show up for me, even if I'm not perfect. Even if I don't always say the thing that I should say. I always like to express it like this. If one of your loved ones does something, you really love that person, and they do something that's wrong, it's not usually too hard for you to forgive them. But if somebody you don't like too well does something to you, you remember it for 42 years. Can I get a witness? Can I get a witness? Love your enemies. Hello. And I see people, if their loved ones, sometimes their loved ones do terrible things. They forgive them all. Just forgive them. Pray for them. You know. And then somebody else does something. And then absolutely not. We're not cutting them any slack. It's too bad. I don't like them. It's not Christ's nature. It's not the way that a Christian should respond. And when we start doing things, all of a sudden, good things begin to happen for people. When we start loving our enemies, we start doing things that helping other people. We show the love of God and the Word of God. But it takes an effort, church. It takes us time to be able to go from where we are to where we need to be. And when we're praying for people and they're sick, you need to keep praying and reading the Bible on your healing scriptures and praying and believing what the Word says until they get a miracle. And sometimes you pray for people And they over and over and over do the same sin. And there are lots of days where you, I'm just so tired of praying for that person. They keep doing the same thing. I'm tired of praying for them. But unless I continue to pray for them, they're not going to get delivered. So if they committed the same sin, I don't care how many times, you've got to pray for them again. And pray for them again until they get delivered. We have people. You have relatives, and so do I. I know people and friends. I know this place could be packed tonight. If people that I know personally would just surrender to the Spirit of God and come out and serve the Lord. But they're not doing that. And so we can quit praying if you want. We can quit worshiping if you want. But if you're ever going to get anybody else in the building, you're going to have to start praying for that person, showing love to that person, and getting them back into the body of Christ is going to take an effort on your part and mine that God will restore. What a great thing it is. Amen. Y'all don't know, even know what I'm talking about. It seems like. You don't know the power that you possess when you get down on your knees and start praying. You don't know what God can do in just 15 minutes. If you will pray earnestly and do like David did, his life was spared, and so with Bathsheba, because he earnestly prayed just like Hezekiah did. And when he turned his face to the wall, he got 15 more years. Hello. That's a pretty good God. That's a pretty good God. Hello. You know, we'll close with this. We're going to pray. I have two dogs. And we had the female trained, and she's pretty good most of the time. But she will, all of a sudden, as I said, deviate from her good habits and get into a bad one sometimes. She knows she's not supposed to eat food off the table, and every now and then, we have a little coffee table. It's just right there. Can I get a witness? I mean, it's just right there. And so she will sneak over and get a bite of something and try to grab a sandwich or a little piece of cake or whatever. When we had the grandkids over, we have them sit at that table where they can eat. It's their level and that sort of thing. And that dog will get over there. The kids, you know, they're not going to eat everything. And so they leave a little something up there. Here come the dog, jump up on the table and go after it. They know better. All I have to do is look at Abby and I say, Abby, did you eat that cake? And she will put her head down. She knows. I do the same thing to Bingo. Bingo, did you do that? He goes out the doggy door and out in the backyard and stares at me. He knows. That's like, I was talking to him the other night, to both of the dogs. And Linda was listening to me. And I forget what I was saying to them. But they understood what I was saying. They haven't had training with every word. They mostly know commands. They know heal and stay and whatever. But they know when I'm talking, they can tell by the sound of my voice that they've done something wrong. But what do they do? Now they're going to come and wiggle their way back up. And they come over to me with their head down. And sometimes they'll even jump in my. And they'll lick my face because they're apologetic. Hello. I'm sorry that I stole the cake. It was really good. But they know. And so even a dog will repent of what they did. Isn't that true? It is true. Both of them will repent because they know what they did was wrong. So should people. So should people. I did it. It was me, wasn't somebody else. I did it, I said it, I whatever. Forgive me, Lord, and help me to some way keep consistent in my Christian walk. Most of the time, we stay established, but if you're honest, you have those days where you kick the dog and throw the cat out. Can I get a witness? God wants us to be consistent, amen, in our walk. So that we can be a blessing to somebody. Amen. Amen. We have to show what Jesus has given us to other people. If we don't do that, how are they ever going to see the love of God in us? And so help us, Lord, to show that kind of love to people, because they need to get saved. I know a truckload of people that should be in the house of God. Hello. I don't know if somebody said something to them or did something to them. I don't know. But we need to get them back in prayer and the Word of God and praise is going to do it. Amen. Would you bow your heads with me tonight? We're going to take time to pray. Lord, we thank you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus for this opportunity that you've given us. And Lord, all of us have been there. And Lord, here Psalmist David prays this beautiful prayer that saved his life, Bathsheba's life, saved him from sure death according to the law. Hezekiah got saved because he sincerely prayed, and you gave him 15 more years. Lord, tonight we want to be more like you, and so we're praying tonight that you'll pour out your Spirit upon us, Lord, that we will be more like you, that we will pray the prayer of faith for our enemies, and that you will bless our efforts, Lord, both in this house and wherever we go. Lord, I thank you for your kindness. I thank you for your mercy. I thank you for your character that, Lord, even when I do the wrong thing, you said that if I will confess my sin, you are faithful and just to forgive me of my sin and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Thank you for that tonight, Lord. Thank you for forgiveness. And Lord, we give you the glory and the praise and the honor. Ask these things tonight in your name, the name of Jesus, and everyone said, amen. Praise the Lord. Anyone here tonight that you would like prayer, if you'll come, we'll be glad to pray with you tonight. Amen. Praise the Lord. Would you stand with me tonight? We're going to go ahead and dismiss in order. Hallelujah. Did you get something out of this tonight? Say amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's remember to pray for all of these during the week, these that are sick. Let's remember Lori's special tomorrow. They're going to do more than one test, but I know that she said they want to do an angiogram. And let's pray if there's any way possible they can put those stents in. It will be the best way to resolve her problem. And let's pray for her. And they have to do certain things, and I understand it. When Sharon had surgery, they had to make sure that her heart was strong enough so she could have surgery. So they have to do tests. So let's pray that Lori will be able to do what she needs to do tomorrow, and that God will be with her like he was with Sharon, and that we'll see her through this. Can I get a witness tonight? Will you join with me and believe that God's going to see her through these situations? Let's continue to lift up these people with healing. We're going to ask our sister Mary Lee, would you dismiss us in a word of prayer, please?
Dear Lord, we enjoyed so much hearing your word, and using David as an example was just a human being. And Lord, we're just human ourselves. Sometimes we do make mistakes or say things we shouldn't, and you're so wonderful to forgive us and made a way because of the price you paid. Thank you for paying the price for us. Thank you for your love and mercy. Take us to our homes and bring us back again, we pray, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you tonight. You're dismissed. Greet someone before you leave and tell them you're glad they came. God bless you tonight. Amen.